All right, everybody. Good morning and welcome to Toyota Stadium in Frisco, Texas for the 2023 FCS Championship pre-championship game press conferences. My name is Jim Powers from the NCAA staff, and it's great to be here once again with everybody. Starting us off this morning is the head coach for South Dakota State, Mr. John Stiegelmeier. Coach, we'll let you start off with opening comments, and then we'll start opening up for questions.
We're honored to be here, represent South Dakota State University and our athletic department. Really proud of our football team this year, and looking forward to a unique championship with our rival, North Dakota State. We've got a ton of respect for North Dakota State, their football program, and looking forward to a great contest on Sunday.
Thank you, Coach. We will open up for questions. Just a couple quick reminders. If you have to leave before the end of the press conference, be mindful of the cameras. We are recording this via Zoom for anybody that couldn't make it here today. So please just keep that in mind. If you have to duck out early, just make sure you don't walk in front of the cameras. So let's start right here, second row.
Coach, Stephen Hawkins with the AP here in Dallas. You mentioned a unique championship against your rival. Where does the line go from it's not the rival to a championship game? And, you know, you talk about the unions. How do you talk to your players about that?
Well, yeah, it's not the rivalry game. It's not the Dakota marker game, which has a life of its own. Obviously, in Frisco, Texas, you're playing for the prize. And so what I meant there is it's against our rival, and I think that's a neat storyline, I think, for both our programs, both our universities, and so, and for the Missouri Valley Football Conference. I know they're excited.
Let's go up in second row. And once again, just a reminder, too, please say your name and your affiliation when you start. Thank you. Go ahead.
Coach Gene Clemens, The Athletic. You were here just not even 2 years ago. I know that you have a lot of players that are back from that team. Has that been something that's been talked about a lot in the circles as you've gotten ready for this?
It has not. It was a totally different scenario in the spring. And the things that have been brought up, one by our players and one by me, specifically are this. We had one player that was his last game. His name's Preston Tetzlaff. He was scheduled to go to law school. And so that locker room for him, and our guys remember that emotion, that locker room for him was to the next level of disappointment and appreciation of the program. The other thing that I brought up is, what did we take from the game? We stayed on the field and watched the trophy presentation. I don't know if other teams do that, but our players chose to do that. I don't know what their motivation was, but it was a cool moment after shaking Sam Houston's hands to stand out there, stay out there, kneel out there in tears, many of them. And to watch the trophy presentation. And I think in the end, it got to their heart that I want to be part of that someday. And here we got a chance to do it. So
we'll go right here in the front row.
Eric Peterson from the Forum newspaper in Fargo. You've had the regular season success against NDSU beam the last three times, but the postseason success is still probably next on the checklist, I guess. Is that important, or how do you use that heading into this game?
Our mental performance coach hit that hard, all right, and challenged our guys. Now, the playoff stuff has been in Fargo, so a different environment, and you know that's a tough environment for the visiting team. Ideally, this will be a environment where there's truly two home teams that will impact either side of the ball or either team, and so. But our mental performance coach, Chris Crack, talked about their record and our record, and it kind of challenged our guys.
And just second one, just Tucker Kraft, I know you mentioned him turning down some NIL money. Just speak to that again and just the value of having a pro prospect like that at tight end.
Yeah, I think in Tucker's situation, there's a lot of lessons, a lot of stories there that will be shared. You know, Tucker's small town, South Dakota, Timberlake, South Dakota, and has had a great career at South Dakota State and had an opportunity to go on and whether I like to say it or not, make a lot of money in NIL at other schools. And he chose to be loyal. He chose to stay committed to South Dakota State football. And so when those things come up in the future, I know we'll point to Tucker and say, look what he did, and he still had an opportunity in the NFL. Tucker's a great teammate and has a bright future in football.
Let's go back third row.
Coach, Craig Haley from Stats Perform. How you doing?
Super, Craig.
Similar to what Eric Peterson just asked, head-to-head against the Bison, during their dynasty, you're the one program that has broken through head-to-head with the results. Why is that, and what's working right for you?
It goes back to 2004. Prior to 2004, look at the record. It wasn't like that. In 2004, both our programs drew a line in the sand, stepped over it, and said, "Let's go Division One. Let's go to Division One together." And I'm sure you've heard the stories of us meeting on the border and looking at a true border marker that was planted in the ground to separate South Dakota and North Dakota. And for a brief second, I think we looked at each other and honestly said, "We need each other." Now, I don't think that's the case now, but that started it. And our guys have responded, and they've been, as we know, Division II, Division I, I don't know about a dynasty, but they've had a great program and a great run. And I think the vicinity, the same conference, all those things surely raised our level of our program. And it's been a great, great run.
Well, the second row right here.
Coach Stephen Hawkins with the AP again. Mark Gronowski, we all know what happened in the game a year and a half ago. Just talk about his comeback, how he's embracing this moment, what he's done as a leader, especially after losing not only that game, but the whole last season.
Well, Mark's comeback and his contribution to our football team is far greater than what you see on the field or in the stats. He's our best leader. He was our best leader as a true freshman, the year he got hurt in the championship. In the fall when we were stumbling around practicing, figuring out how to do it, and we all were, I had players coming into my office saying, "Mark's got to be our starting quarterback. Here's a true freshman that's been on campus a month and a half." Specifically this year, he learned from Chris Olodokun, having to watch. Chris was a seasoned guy in terms of age, but not a lot of playing time. Chris is with the Kansas City Chiefs now, and so he had a great mentor in terms of film watching and preparation. And this is the honest to God truth. In a two-hour practice, Mark does not miss a rep. Meaning when the twos are going, he is standing beside that taking the rep. I don't know of another player in my tenure at South Dakota State that's ever done that at any position. And he does it, whether it's 2 minute or inside or whatever. And so we use the term leave nothing to chance. He's a picture of that. And he's a great teammate.
We'll keep it right in the second row.
Coach Gene Clemens at the Athletic again. I coach, and I know after a season, 2, 3, 4 years in, I feel exhausted. You've been at this thing for longer than many people. Some people in here have been alive. Like, how have you been able to maintain the level of juice and change with the times that have allowed you to bring your team to this level?
Well, you should maybe ask our players if I have been able to do that, right? That's, I am certain God made me to be a coach. And so there's some accountability to that assignment in life. And I stumbled into this thing being a student coach, didn't play college football, and have had unbelievable mentors along the way that I didn't know I needed, but that when I look back, which is the way life always is, I did need. And so 26 years ago, 35, when I got to South Dakota State, 26 when I became the head coach, I felt a responsibility to do what I felt called to do. And so it's easy to jump out of bed and feel you're living a calling. And surely, based on the color of my hair, things have passed me by. They tell me I'm drippy, and I'm not sure what that means. And I think it's droopy. They said I look good in my clothes. But what a motivation that is to be around young men like that and the type of guy both of us have in our program. It's just it's motivating. It really is. But that's an interesting question. Thanks.
Let's go second row over on the far side, Coach.
Derek Hansen, KFGO Radio in Fargo. Obviously, the first meeting, the second half was very good for you. I mean, how much do you look at film, and how much different do you think NDSU looks? I mean, do you see them all differently? Is there December playoff mode is going on here?
Well, I think without the Lipke, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing his name correct, but without him, they're a little different. They've always had a guy like that, And to me, he is the best at doing all those things they used him at, whether it's tight end, fullback, tailback. And so they're without him personnel-wise. They're still going to run power. They're still going to run quarterback run. They're still going to run the wrap ISO type play inside, G-ISO, what we call. Defensively, you can't outnumber them. They're unbelievably well coached, and so you got to beat them. You can't outsmart them, and they don't give you the same look. So, other than the few guys they're missing, I don't think they're any different. They are the best coached team we faced, and the Missouri Valley's got great coaches. So we're looking forward to the challenge.